Hi, this is Paul Schreiber. Welcome you back for part two of our series on using the Tina Spice program on a simple RC circuit. And here's where we left off. We have an IC analysis where we have a low-pass filter. The green is the capacitor output voltage, and the red is the voltage across our resistor. So I want to show you some different ways how you can label these easily. First off, we see this little symbol up here, which is a question mark and a little anchor arrow. That's called auto label. So if we do this and do a mouse drag till it changes to a crosshair, you can see we'll attach the output voltage VM2 with this little arrow. That's very useful. The other way to do it is to split these graphs into two separate graphs instead of one overlapping graph. And you can do this by the view separate outputs. You can see here that we have separated our outputs and the software has labeled our markers with the label NDB. It doesn't say DB down here. I have no idea why. Ask your favorite program. So let's look at what we call the slope of the filter. You can see that this is a linear slope in DB negative. The resistor is a positive slope in DB. But we've always heard that filters with a one pole, and this is a one pole filter, has one reactive component, has a slope of 6 dB per octave. And now we can see, really, to be technically true, it's minus 6 dB per octave. But we'll forget the minus sign for now, and I'll call it 6 dB per octave because everybody else has. So let's use our cursors and see where we can see the 6 dB per octave. So we'll click on cursor A, attach it to the green, and drag this down here so we can see it better. I'll put this at minus 3 dB, which is our cutoff frequency. And you can see that our cutoff frequency is 158 Hz. I'm going to use cursor B, just click it anywhere, and use the feature where I can just type in the values and we'll move the cursor either on X or Y axis. So if I'm 6 dB down, that's a minus 9. If I type a minus 9 here, I expect the delta to be the same thing, one octave away. The delta is the double. Double minus the same thing is the same thing. I should see 158.77 here and here, and the answer is nope. It's 260 Hz. That means the slope is much less than 6 dB. It's more like 3.5 dB. So what's going on? Well, the answer is, in order to see the 6 dB slope, you have to be down in this region. You have to be what we call, in very technical terms, far away. Or, if you like the movie Shrek, far, far away. Just how far do we have to be? The answer is about 5 octaves away. In other words, to see this down here to be really an octave and 6, I would have to be like, say, 3 kilohertz and 6 kilohertz. And now I see that I am, in fact, 6.01 away and not 6. Now, if you use Spice, you have to understand that Spice does a lot of rounding up and down. And so you think to yourself, maybe this is just a math error. The answer is, no, it's not. This actually is a significant number. I'll show you why here in a second. What happens if we take these cursors and go to the land of far, far away out here? So I'm going to go at 10 kilohertz and 20 kilohertz. And notice that our 6.01 has now magically changed to 6.02. And boys and girls, that's the answer. So every time you've read your whole life that the slope of a one-pole filter is 6 dB per octave, they're lying to you. It's a lie. It's 6.02. Aren't you glad you know that now? Now, a fair question is, how come they never say 6.02? Why don't they just say it's 6.02? Why they keep saying 6? Well, I don't know. Maybe back in the 1920s, they got paid by the typesetters for every character they put in the book. But I've never seen 6.02 in any textbook ever. It's always 6. So let's just chalk this up till you learn something new every day. Now we're going to close this window and talk about the transient analysis. Now, transient is a short-lived signal that's 0 is active and then goes back to 0. Well, in the synthesizer world, that's a gate or a trigger. It turns out that SPICE has a pre-built signal that's perfect for simulating gates and triggers. So we're going to go to our voltage generator, right-click on Properties, and there it is, the pulse. So the pulse is the first selection. It goes from 0 to a value for some time back to 0, and notice there's no parameters for the rise and fall time. It does it in 0 time. Now that's, of course, impossible. It has to have some slew rate, even if it's 1 picosecond. It's got to have some slew rate. But in this SPICE simulation, if you want to have slew rates, you have to move from the built-in pulse function over here to what's called the arbitrary piecewise linear, and you can add your rise and fall times. The next question is, what is going to be our time? That's a good question. The answer is, we're going to type in 12 milliseconds, because I've already done the calculations, and I know that 12 milliseconds will give us a nice pretty graph. And we'll see where I got 12 milliseconds here in just a second. Close it. Now we're going to run our analysis of transient. We're usually going to run it for twice our pulse width. I'll show you why. It'll be very obvious why I want to do twice. Down here, we don't have to type the number of points. We have initial conditions, which are always 0, so we don't have to worry about initial conditions. We want to draw our little pulse wave. And here it is. So here's our three outputs. Our square wave, which I guess is an input, to be honest. The voltage on the cap. Voltage across the resistor. Now the voltage on the cap looks just like an attack, sustain, release envelope generator, just because it just so happens to be an attack, sustain, and release. The voltage across the resistor seems to be very odd. It actually goes up and goes down. There doesn't seem to be any reason to make it go down. There's no signal that says go down. The signal's up all the time. So why in the world would it go down? How does it even know to go down? Why is it going down? What's it go down to? And then you come over here, if you look at this and say, well, this looks like it's ground, minus 1 to plus 1 with this in the middle, ground. Wait a minute, it's going towards minus 1? Where's the minus coming from? There's no minus over here. There's no negative voltage. The answer is, it's minus because this is a relative measurement across the resistor, not reference to ground. This is the same thing that would happen if you took a 9-volt battery and on your digital voltmeter, and you put the leads on correctly and you read 9 volts, then you swap the leads and you read minus 9 volts. The battery didn't change, but the reading changed. The reading changed relative to what the terminals on your voltmeter called the high side and the low side. The battery never changed. Same thing over here. We didn't change anything, but the voltage reference to this terminal changed polarity, because when you charge the capacitor, the current is flowing this way. This is called sourcing current. This is a positive voltage, but when we go down to 0, this sinks the current this way, and now this is positive. If I were to take this voltmeter and flip it so the plus is over here, these would flip as well. In other words, it would start going negative, come up here, and go positive at the end. And the reason it does this is because, as we remember from our first lecture, we have to conserve all our energy. So if you add this to this, you should always get that, right? What happens? Well, if we start at 0 and we're going up, we better start at 1 and go down. Unless it doesn't go all the way up to 1. Why not? Well, because we have non-perfect components here, especially we have a non-perfect capacitor. If it was a perfect world, this would not even have a ramp time here. It would go instantly to 1 and then ramp down and go instantly to minus 1, because if we start at 1, we have to have a minus 1 to get 0. That's why. So the energy and this little spike, it's the same as energy here, energy in this little spike, same as energy under here, and that's how energy is conserved. Now let's see if it really does go to 1. If I take my cursor and I anchor it to green, I anchor it over here for, as we like to say in the business, dramatic effect. And I slide, I'm going to move this down a little bit. Well, in fact, I'll move over here. I want to slide my A, and at some point, my Y should read a volt. And we slide it back and forth, and we see it reads never a volt. So we get very close to where it goes back to 0. It's lots of 9s, never a 1. Why is that? Because the math says this is an asymptote, and you never can get to the input voltage. Does it matter if this is 1 volt, a millionth of a volt, or a million volts? You'll never get there because the equation won't let you. Now, in reality, if you actually build a circuit, you'll probably get there. A bonus question is, what would cause it not to get there? Think about it. But in theory, you should get there. But this will say it won't get there. And this is one of the things you have to understand about SPICE, is that SPICE is running a mathematical model, which is only as good as the model that you put in, but it's bound by these models, and sometimes the models will not give you the exact perfect answer. Now, a lot of people don't like SPICE because of that. Why should I spend all my time and effort for something that won't give me the answer? I'll just go build it. If you built a lot of circuits, you realize that usually doesn't give you the right answer either. So I like to do both. Now let's talk about what's a time constant. One time constant is the value of R times C. That happens to be 1 millisecond. So if I type in 1 millisecond over here, what do I find out? I find out that my voltage will rise around 62% of the maximum value. Now, it doesn't matter if this is 1 volt or a million volts. It's still a percent. That's why I like to use 1 volt here, so I can easily read out that I know that's 61.38%. So let's see what happens in two time constants. 2 milliseconds, it's up to around 87%. 3 time constants, 95%. So how long does it take to actually get to the voltage we expect? The industry rule is it takes 8 time constants, or 8 milliseconds. So you can hear if we type in 8 milliseconds at 99.972, actually. And that's what the industry uses to say the signal has been what's called acquired. We have fully acquired the voltage on the capacitor. We'll talk about sample and holds here in just a second, about acquisition time of a sample and hold circuit. Even though people would say this is still in a sustained portion, we've already attacked. Our attack has been done way back here. It really takes a little bit of time to get to the full sustain level, and then it will release. Since it has the same charge and discharge path, this time here is the same as this time here. Now, if we were to build an envelope generator, we want to stick a pot in there to get a variable attack. We want different attack and release times. So we'd have two pots, and we'd have to have two diodes, because you want one resistor slash pot to charge the cap, and then when the thing is discharged, it's going to block that path. There'll be a new path to another diode to have a separate release time. Now let's talk finally about sample and holds. So I'm going to come over here and change this value to a typical value for the on resistance of a switch used in a sample and hold, which is 100 ohms. You can get analog switches which is much less than that, but you have to pay so much, and you guys know who you are. You're not paying $5 for a switch, are you? Nope. You're going to use a 4066 out of your junk box. So we're not going to leave the cap alone. The cap value is usually bigger because you don't want this thing to what's called droop. You want it to go flat forever, so it's usually a buffer here, and you want to reduce the droop. So we'll talk about sample and hold droops in another tutorial. Right now, it's going to look at the acquisition time. Well, we've already told ourselves we don't really have to run a simulation. We know for a fact that if I change the resistor, that's going to be a 10 microsecond. That's 80 microseconds, but we'll just verify that. We'll run this again with different times. Let's go into an analysis view, transient. Instead of 25 milliseconds, I want to run it for 1 millisecond. And sure enough, you see down here, less than 100 microseconds, we have our attack time. So let's zoom in. Go to A, anchor the A, drag this over here, type in 80 micro, and you'll notice something interesting. Notice here it says 1. It does not say 0.9999999999. It actually gives us the answer of 1, which if you just listened to me and you weren't dozing off, I told you it can't be 1 because the equation can't make it 1. Why is it 1? This is Tina rounding up. So you can go into the properties and say, you know, if I have 0.917 digits long, we're just going to call that 1. So this thing has 6-digit rounding. So what this means is that when it ran this calculation, it got 0.99999 and said, I'm going to call it 1. So why would this calculation be different? The answer is because there's less loss in the resistor due to the leakage current of the capacitor, and that was enough to bump it down by millionths of a volt, and it rounded up to 1. Well, that concludes today's tutorial on sample and hold envelope generators, all derived from our simple RC circuit. Hope to see you again.